My first tip on how to choose a great indie app for you to build is to minimize complexity. What does that mean? It means keep the project small, finite, solve one problem, do it well. Build something that when it's done, it's done. For example, one of my apps, Roast App, you submit a picture to AI, it comes back with a roast. Very simple, and it's done. There's not 10 features I need to add. Of course, you can always add polish, animation, spruce it up a bit, but by and large, once it's done, it's done. Same thing with my F1 widgets app. Got a bunch of stats, F1 widgets, it's done. There's like not a ton more features to add to that. There's a finite scope and the project is small. This allows you to do small bets. You can build a bunch of these, see which ones catch on, show a little bit of success, and then double down on those. Now, a poor example of minimizing complexity is my first app, CreatorView. It does way too much. It's like income tracking for YouTubers, scheduling, goal tracking, a little bit of YouTube analytics in there, expense tracking. It's like 5 apps in one. And even after working on it off and on for a few years now, it's still only about 25% of what I envisioned. That is an example of a project being way too big, something that you can build forever. You're just never gonna finish that type of project. And by working on it so much, you're putting all of your eggs in one basket and not making a bunch of small bets to see what catches on. So keep the project small, minimize the complexity. Now, quick disclaimer, every piece of advice I'm gonna give in this video, there will be a counterexample of someone doing the exact opposite and having success. This is not blanket advice, 100% absolutely true. It is general advice that is going to be correct for most developers. Today's video is sponsored by WishKit. The next tip for choosing the right project to build is to make sure it fits in with your lifestyle. Are you married, 3 kids, full-time job? Well, then you really want to lean into minimizing that complexity, keeping the app super simple. That way you have a completed app that you can refine and polish and then focus on the marketing. That's way better than taking on a large project that you're never gonna have time to finish because your life just doesn't allow it. Now, on the flip side of that, are you in your 20s, single, no kids, have all the time in the world? Well, then hell yeah, go big. Take on that larger project. Or maybe build 20 small bet apps and see which ones catch on. You have a lot more flexibility with that. But the point is, both can work, right? One's not right or wrong or better than the other. The point is to just make sure you're picking the right project for your lifestyle. Like, don't try to shove a square peg into a round hole. Take an honest assessment of your time and choose the project scope accordingly. The next thing you need to know is that building the app is actually the easy part, especially with AI. Marketing the app, getting people to download your app, getting people to open up their wallets and spend money on the app, getting people to stay with your app longer than 1 month, that is extremely hard. So back to what I was saying about choosing the right project scope for how much time you have in your life, make sure that time is allotted at least 50-50 building and marketing. You could probably even argue more towards marketing than building. So for example, if you are that married, 3 kids, full-time job, make sure you're also budgeting time for marketing, not just building. That is if you're trying to make money from these indie apps. If this is just a hobby, you love the game, you just love to build, well then this advice is irrelevant. And marketing your app is a lot easier when you adhere to my next piece of advice, and that is solve your own problem. Build a product you wish existed for a specific pain point that you personally have. That is by far the best way to go for many reasons. Let's start with what I was just talking about, the marketing. If you yourself are the typical customer, you'll be much better at marketing to yourself, right? You'll be familiar with the community around this problem, the subreddits, the influencers, the YouTubers, the newsletters, the podcasts, all the stuff around this problem, this pain point, this space, you're gonna be very familiar with. For example, my app CreatorView, you know, the one that does way too much and is way too big. Well, I built all that because I built the thing I wanted to exist. Like, I was the customer. I use the thing every day to run my YouTube business. And because I'm the customer, I'm very familiar with the influencers in the space. I know the newsletters, the podcasts, all that stuff I talked about. So when it comes to spending money on the marketing, I'm going to know what's a value, what's not a value. And same thing with my F1 app. Again, huge F1 fan. So I know all the influencers, the YouTubers, the people to follow on Twitter. And a nice thing when you're actually in that community is you're going to know the up and coming influencers. Maybe the people that are really good, but they haven't caught on yet. They don't have millions of followers. And that's where the real value is when you're doing influencer marketing. But my point is, however you market your app, when you yourself are the main customer, you're gonna have a much easier time knowing how to market that thing effectively. And solving your own problem also allows you to build a much better product. Because remember, you are the customer. It's your pain point. You know it very intimately. So you can build the first version of the app based on your specific needs. And this is a huge head start. You don't have to talk to a bunch of customers and try to figure out what to build. You know. Now, of course, I'm talking about the first version. Once you build that first version, maybe you get some traction, the app gets bigger. Of course, you're gonna have to talk to customers, go beyond your specific viewpoint on this problem, but building a product for yourself and solving your problem is an amazing head start. And the last reason you should solve your own problem is you're just gonna be more passionate about it. Because the truth is, building products is hard. Marketing the product is hard. You're gonna hit roadblocks. You're gonna hit plateaus. It is going to be a grind. So if you're trying to build an app around a problem you don't really care about, well, it's high likelihood you're gonna give up, you're not gonna push through. If you're trying to solve a problem you have and you're deeply passionate about, you're more likely to persist, push through those roadblocks, get over those plateaus, go through the grind, and make it out the other side. The next tip is to play to your strengths. And what I mean by that is, let's say you're a full-time iOS developer, maybe you work at Uber, DoorDash, something that involves maps. You have a very deep knowledge of maps due to your day job. Well, if you build a product that involves maps, again, that gives you a huge head start because you already have all that existing knowledge. Now, I admit solving your own problem in something that you deal with in your day job, those paths might not cross. So this might not be possible for everyone, but if it's possible, if you have huge experience in one area of iOS development, if you can kind of stay in that area, again, another huge advantage. And then you should validate your idea before you start building. Now, this is kind of do as I say, not as I do, because I struggle with this one. There's many people out there that will research keywords, find very high popularity keywords, low difficulty, doesn't matter what the app is, they'll use the ASO and the keyword research to then build the app. They don't care what it is. I just can't do that. Like, I have to, again, solve my own problem. I have to care about the app that I'm building. And I'm not saying that's right or wrong, that's just me personally. So I say validate your idea, that is probably the better advice, but me personally, I build what I want to build. I like it, and sometimes they don't work out, sometimes they do, but it is probably pretty good advice to validate your idea with some keyword research first. Once you've figured out what to build, you've built that initial version, well, now you need some customer feedback. Let the customers tell you what features to build next, and that brings me to today's sponsor, WishKit. You can drop in the WishKit SDK with only a couple lines of code, and you get a completely built and customizable view that allows your users to create new feature requests, and like I said, upvote existing new ones. I just implemented it myself in Creator View recently, like that's what you're seeing right here. I'm loving it so far. You get access to this backend dashboard where you can see and manage your new feature request. It's like a nice Kanban view. You can see like, yeah, this is in review, this is in progress, this is completed. And your users will see that too, as you see here in this screenshot. So they are constantly updated on like what the progress is on this feature that they requested. Now the dashboard you're seeing is pretty light because this is actually my implementation in Creator View. Creator View doesn't have a ton of users. I put it in my settings screen, so not a lot of action yet, but you can see the analytics of the users viewing it. Again, you see mine, not a lot of action, but I'm looking forward to seeing this grow over time. Again, I just put it into my app. Now I've interacted with Martin, the creator of WishKit, for years on Twitter and watched him build this in public. So I'm a happy user of WishKit and I was happy to work with him on sponsoring this video. There's a free tier so you can check it out at no cost. Give it a try. I bet you're gonna like it. Link is in the description.